Well, we're currently walking through the book of Acts, talking about how the New Testament followers of Jesus, empowered by the Holy Spirit, changed the world. And much of what we're going to talk about today is how Northfield is putting that into action. Today's message is directly related to part three of our mission statement, which says, love God, love people, and make Jesus known. That is right. Taking up that mantle and making Jesus known in the same way that Acts 1:8 made it known. In fact, Acts 1:8 is the verse that we adopted for how we wanted to spread the gospel to our world. You know, when he said they're going to be his witnesses, starting right there in their hometown, but then they're going to spread out to Judea, to Samaria, and then they're going to take this message to the ends of the earth. And that is our goal as well. And while there are a lot of things to do that we do right here in our community to make Jesus known, mission trips are the primary way that we send groups of people and hopefully encourage those of us who go and those of us who make possible the ones who go the way that we make Jesus known to the ends of the earth. And we're going to need, as you're going to hear in today's message, we're going to need your fervent prayers throughout the month of October. And I'm asking you, so today's going to look a bit different as I tell you about two of the groups that are going out. Partnering with Agape to the Nations. Many of you know Charlie and Kinsley Smith. You have gone on some of the mission trips with them. In fact, I'll go ahead and say it now since it's up on the screen. That QR code, if you want to know about their 10 mission trips that they're going on in the year 2025, you can click that, read about all 10 trips that they'll be making to different places around the world, including the one in February that is where we do Night to Shine in the Dominican Republic. Anyway, that is what slide is. It tells a little bit about, but going in the month of October, they will be leaving next Friday. So it's going to be three of our high school young ladies, three of our high school young men, our student pastor Trent, our student and young adults administrator Amy, and then Kinsley, the director of Agape to the Nations, and their admin, also named Amy. And speaking of students, I'd like to give a shout out to young sophomore Brooke on the stage. She is a sophomore in high school. I don't know where she is right now, but just an incredible job. And just thank you. All of our high school kids, many of you are sitting right over here right now, too. Anyway, while they're in the Dominican, they're going to be working with kids from traditional housing who have aged out of their country's fostering system. They're going to be working with Mercy Workshops. Some of you who were at the ladies' event may remember the booth where they were selling jewelry for Mercy Workshops. It's where they take women off the streets who have gotten sometimes into sexual industries and exploited. They take them in, give them places to work, ways to make money, and to support their families. So they will be working and finding out more about that this week. They'll be going in the community. They'll be sharing the gospel just in the streets, doing some street mission work. They'll be feeding people, bringing hope. One of the biggest things they're going to do is they're going to evaluate whether we're going to be able to go back year after year and make this an annual fall break trip for our high school students. So I'm excited about that. I want you to be praying that that this will be a kind of our dive in to figuring out ways to take larger groups of high school people and make this an every year trip. Anyway, as I said, you can scan that QR code. You can find out more about it, especially for those of you. I think there were like 20 or even more that went on the Night to Shine Dominican retreat trip last year in February. That is coming up again. The second team I want to tell you about this morning is our Africa Missions team. You may have noticed a few people, I think there are about 15 of us, wearing the t-shirts this morning. We're partnering with our own Hope Springs International, operated by, they're sitting right over here, Northville Shepherd Lee Hodges and his wife Barbara. We're going to be traveling to the country of Nigeria. For security reasons, we can't tell you the exact location or even the exact day that we'll be going, but know it's going to be in the month of October. But wanted to give you a short video to see first. It's part of a larger video. One of the ladies in the video is very emotional, and I hope as you watch the video and then you hear me tell a little bit later, you'll understand reasons for her being emotional about that. But this is just a short snippet to give you an idea of what Hope Springs International does. Thank you.
before Hope Springs came to this particular community, kids were dying of waterborne illnesses in droves, just scores and scores of them.
Being here gives me perspective of how much we have and how much need is here. It's just so sad to know that they have nothing. And they're so happy. And they have to work so hard to get anything that they have. But they're just special people. I'm just so blessed to be here to help.
The thing that just blows my mind is the immense joy I find among the believers of Africa. That's something we need back home in the United States. We need to realize that all of the stuff we have, all of the creature comforts we have, all of the things that we enjoy, they really haven't made us any more happy.
Thank you. Most of that video was taken in 2019, the last time that we took a trip to a village that at one time was predominantly Muslim, but now have churches there, over 1,300 kids a day learning the Bible in a school that that you have helped support. It was a medical and dental mission trip then. And we go into some of the hardest reaching places in Africa. There are a lot of places in Africa where people go that are easy to get to. The places where Hope Spring goes are not easy to get to places. They are places that are generally left behind. And over the last several years, working through Hope Springs, I just wanted to again to remind you guys of what you have provided. 85 wells by our church family alone. You can clap yes. Bringing clean water to more than 250,000 people. Through your donations, we continue to operate a school that now educates over 1,300 students per day, teaching Bible and Jesus in predominantly non-Christian environments. Through building and funding two healthcare centers, we treated over 10,000 people. Lee told me in 2023, 2024, we will surpass that, giving special attention to ladies who are pregnant with prenatal decisions. Before the wells were drilled in the community that you just saw online, the death rate of kids under 5 years old was greater than 20%. Let me tell you, as of today, through the health center and the clean water, the rate of infant mortality is less there than it is in the United States of America. I would say that is doing for others what we would have them do to you. And that happened because you people and the church in general gave every month, and there's still 50 orphans out there who are unadopted right now, but every month, people from our Northville family alone sponsor over 125 orphans to the tune of in excess of $75,000 a year, bringing them clean water, two meals a day, and so much more. We're going to certainly tell you later more, there are more to come and other opportunities, but what we wanted you to do today is to know about the opportunity that is in October to change not just a person, but four entire villages. The population of the four villages are about 13,000 people. Over the next few weeks, we will once again be sending out a team of dentists, hygienists, nurses, and doctors, including Stephanie, who's on stage a lot. I call her our singing dentist, and she is the founder of the dental clinic here at Northfield. I will be making the trip, thus my t-shirt. It'll be my first trip, along with Danny, who works with our students, Mackenzie in our student center. John, who generally plays bass on stage, is making the trip with us. Lee Hodges is going. His daughter, Joyce, who is sitting kind of one seat in between them. Melissa, the leader of our praise team this morning, is going, as well as a few other people that are not from our congregation here. During that time, we're going to be on the ground for about 12 days. During those 12 days, we'll be joined by the Hope Springs team that live and work, and they are of African nationality themselves, and they are Christians who work in Africa, in some areas that are very risky to be in. In addition to that, we're going to be traveling with 10 medical personnel from a Nigerian hospital who are going to be there to do follow-up visits. We're going to have the opportunity not only to evaluate our continuing work in Africa, but actually provide and give life-saving dental care along with other help to the villages I mentioned. I speak to Lee a lot, and so Lee and I, we have a lot of things going on, but he was telling me about a guy in Abilene, Texas, who's an emergency room doctor, who went on a very similar trip to an area that is not far from this a little over a year ago, but not 2 years ago, so I'm going to call it a year and a half. And I wanted to talk to him, so Lee helped me track him down. Dr. Lawson is his name. He goes between hospitals in Abilene, Texas, but also he has made about 80 trips to Africa over the last 30 years, several to areas near where we're going to. And I called him and I said, "This is my first year, Dr. Lawson. What should I expect? I want to be able to tell our church family what we're getting into, because I don't want to hide from you. You guys have already, through just your donations and tithes and offerings, we already have about $30,000 from you guys into this trip, making sure that we've got hygienists to go, making sure that we've got the medicine that we're going to need, the generators, tents, because a lot of our work is going to be not in a building, but out in a tent in the middle of a field or under a tree is where we're going to be." This is what he told me. He said, number one, I will try not to get emotional. He said, "You will see poverty like you have not seen poverty before, if you were like most Americans." He said, "But you'll also see a joy that is unexplainable in the midst of that poverty. The area where you'll be," he said, "is predominantly Muslim, but," he said, "don't think extremist as you often think of because of our news networks. Think of hardworking people with families, mostly farmers, who struggle to make enough to feed their family daily." When I asked him what stood out the most about the trip that he took almost 2 years ago, he said, number one, he said, "I wasn't prepared for grown men to fall at my feet, hold on to my legs, and literally sob, thanking me for the gift of a bag of rice so that their family would have a full meal for that day." He told me that we could expect more people to be lined up before we even start our day than we'll be able to treat that day. He told me that we will have to have some of our team who will go throughout the line looking for the cases that are the worst of the worst who need to be helped first and finding a way to pull them out and get them to the front of the line. The people in the four villages we will be going to will have never seen a doctor. They will have never seen a nurse or a dentist until the month of October, and we're about to change that. For many of them, he said, "You will be the first white person they have ever seen, and some of them will be scared to death of you." He then added this, "For most of the people you see, you and your team will be the first contact they have ever had with a follower of Jesus Christ." The area we are traveling to has seen its share of political difficulties, and our first 2 days will be in an orphanage of just over 300 people. Because of what I'm telling you next is the reason we want you to be in fervent prayer over this trip. Many of you may have heard of the terrorist group Boko Haram. Several years ago, a cell of them made their way down into actually one of the villages where we're going to be. They divided the Muslims from the Christians, and they gave the Christians a chance to deny their faith. To those Christians who did not, they slaughtered over 1,000 of them that day in the village in front of their children. The 300-plus children we will visit, give medical and dental treatment to on our first 2 days there are the very children who were left orphaned from that tragic event. Most of them still remember the sights and sounds of the days their parents were killed. And while the terrorists were chased back by the Nigerian military back across the northern border, the effects of what they did have left scars that remain both on the children and on that community at large. Dr. Lawson said there are several. He said, "You still have a guy there preaching the gospel, and you still have people who are turning to Jesus." He said, in fact, 49 in just the last little bit of time that he was counting. They got the number just the other day of the people who were worshiping. He said, "I can tell you your brothers and sisters are scared. They are nervous there." What you are about to see in just a second is a short video clip that I asked Melissa to put together. It was brought to us by one of our African people on the ground that Lee had gotten a camera to, one of our Christian volunteers there. I'm going to show you just a couple of single shots, and then we'll put the video together, realizing it wasn't made like we have all the stuff to make a video with. But the compound here that you see, that compound was already just outside the village that we're going to be going on to, but there wasn't a lot on it. You can see the word college there. I don't even know that we know exactly what was going on at the time that was put up. But that area or that compound is where the 300-plus orphans live right now. It is just outside the main village. To give you an idea of the proximity of the village, we have a Google Earth photo where we've got this area right through there. If you can see that little yellow, that is kind of that compound where the orphans live. Village is right through here, right over here, and right over here. There are a little over 3,000 plus people who live right through there, plus the 300 orphans who live there. There is a small river. This is a small river. It might even be called it a creek that stays dry most of the year. The way that the kids in the village would get their water is they would go to the places that seem darker. And sometimes this shows up as water here, but often that water is just under the surface of the earth where they will have to wait for it to seep up. They had little pans where they would get the water, put it in stuff, and then they would carry it back to the village. And that is how a lot of them would get sick. They were taken to that village a couple of years ago. They had no clean water source, and that is where Hope Springs and our Northville family entered the picture for this particular community. One of the wells that we provided in 2022, the money came from you guys buying coffee in the coffee shop and from Vacation Bible School, where our children's pastors had the kids bring in money to build another well. Lee took that money. He built from our kids to their kids the well that you're going to see in just a few minutes on the video. And as you see the short video, you'll see that white and pink compound. They like bright colors. But you'll also see a truck bringing in two 1,500-gallon water tanks that will hold the water. And now that water is not just for that community of orphans there. The water actually feeds, if we could go back one, the water actually feeds this entire village now. The well is over here on their grounds, but people from the village come, and it is supplying water to all of those. And then go to that next slide. You'll see from that, the well is made, there's a tower, and then they're able to make these faucets here. You see Hope Springs there. They kind of all put that together, and you'll see that working as you see the video. Then you'll see the 300-plus kids there playing with clean water. And when you see this video, you need to know, it is the very first time any of those kids will have ever touched clean water running through a faucet. We turn it on every day. I don't think in our minds we can grasp what we're talking about here. So when you see those kids, no, it is the first time they've ever seen water coming out of a faucet. And then last, what you're going to see is them thanking you. And as you watch, I hope you'll see what a difference you have made in a largely forgotten part of our world. I don't know how that touches you, but what you have helped do through Hope Springs and the work that Lee and Barbara do is nothing short of miraculous, as you have been the hands and feet of Jesus. The man saying thank you, thank you, thank you is the director of the orphanage there. He is a believer and a follower of Jesus and really risked his own life to do that every day. And those are the kids whose parents chose to pay the ultimate sacrifice for their faith. And we have the opportunity to help. And they now have clean water because of our church family and your faith. None of those kids that you see in this picture or in this video will have seen a doctor or a nurse or a dentist until we get there in October. It will be their first experience. And we will not be treating, and we will not only be treating the life-changing and giving life-changing medicine for them, but the village that their parents lived in as well. And that whole village will know the reason that we came is because of the God we serve. And here's the ask for today. The ask for today is this. We've already purchased from the tithes and offerings you give weekly, as I told you, right at $30,000 worth of equipment, sending two hygienists from Stephanie's office with us on this trip, generators to run the equipment. But all of that stuff, Dr. Lawson told me when I talked to him, he said, how long are you going to be there? And I told him how long we're going to be there. He said, we were there for 5 days and we ran out. He said, we ran out right in the middle. He said, every day you'll have to decide when to stop. It will be a hard decision. You will have to decide when you're going to stop giving out stuff. But I'm going to tell you, with the money that we have already sent, he asked how much, and I told him, I don't remember the exact number. Lee would know it. That's dental and how much are the medical stuff. But then he said this. He said you're going to need $10,000 more. You're going to need $10,000 more. And we as a church, we could just go ahead and write that check and do it. But we're going to give each of you an opportunity, if you want to go without something for the next few weeks and say, you know what, over and above what I normally do, I want to make that happen. But then he added this that I wasn't aware of, and then I go back and I ask Lee. He said, what are you doing about food? And I said, well, I don't really know. It's my first trip. I'm not sure what we're doing about food. He goes, you need to bring food. He goes, almost every person that you meet, they will be hungry. And then he said this, some of the people, when they find out you're in the village, they will have walked 10 to 12 hours from another village to get to your village. Most of them drinking dirty water as they come. Most of them with nothing to eat, maybe a little bit of a snack. They will be hungry. You got to do something with food. And I said, how much we need for food? He said, you'll run out even if you provide $10,000. So we just upped it 10 and said, let's take $15,000 worth of food for meals and let's take $10,000 and another $10,000, making it $25,000. So I don't know. I'm just on the spur of the moment throwing out a goal of $25,000. I assure you, I think we'll get it from our church family. If we get more than $25,000, I assure you that every bit that we raise will go for efforts like this and for other trips like this. You can scan the QR code there. You can give the way you normally give online. There's a special block that is just about this mission trip. He said, until you see the great need, you will not understand. Most of the people you meet will live on one meal or less a day. So that's our ask. In the next 2 weeks, before we make that start that final flight, could we give over and above what we normally give to provide additional medical supplies of $10,000 and meals of $15,000? I looked, and if just half of the people who visit here today gave $25 each, we would more than cover that. Another thing to know, he said this, in this largely non-Christian area, we already have a couple of churches, and we already have pastors on the ground who will be staying after we leave. Dr. Lawson told me that the people there are scared because of what happened, but the good works we are doing are still bringing people to Christ. I think I already told you that. He said 49 just over the last few months. And again, when I look at that, Jesus has proven to be right. When you don't hide your light, but when you let your light shine, when you're that city on a hill, people see it and they give glory to your Father who is in heaven. It is an opportunity we have to bring health and healing, both physically and spiritually, to this part of the world. I'm going to ask any of the team members who are going either on the Dominican trip that leaves next Friday or on the Africa mission trip to join me on stage. And then I've asked our executive pastor, Mike Parker, to lead us in a prayer. And I'm going to ask each of you over the next month of October, if you will, it would be such an honor. And don't be afraid. Come on up. It would be such an honor if you would put us on a prayer list and make these two trips a daily offering of prayer on your behalf. As they're coming up, the other thing that I've asked Mike to pray about is the devastation that's occurred from the floods right here in our own country, and especially in the Knoxville area and going east and then down south towards Florida. So those are the three things we're going to be praying over. And I wanted you to hear the words of Jesus because, church family, I think you've lived them out so well. And I just wanted you to hear the words of Jesus. They're recorded by Matthew, and I'll be reading the words from the Message. When the Son of Man finally arrives, blazing in beauty, and all of his angels with him, he will take his place on God's glorious throne. Then all the nations of the earth will be arranged before him, and he will sort the people out, much as a shepherd in the field sorts out the sheep from the goats, putting sheep to the right and goats to the left. Then our King Jesus will say to those on his right, "Enter, you who are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation, and this is the reason. I was hungry, and you fed me. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was homeless, and you gave me a room. I was cold and shivering, and you put clothes on my back. I was sick, and you stopped to visit me. I was in prison, and you came to see me." Then those sheep are going to look and say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you?" Then the king will say, "I tell you a solemn truth here. Whenever you did it to one of these, to someone who was overlooked or ignored, it was just as if you did it for me." My.
That's pretty good. God, what an incredible opportunity we have as a church family to just a moment to step into lives of folks who, Lord, are so filled with joy, yet are so filled with need. Basic needs, Lord, of food and water and medical attention. And Lord, I'm thankful that we have folks who have said yes to going. And Lord, I pray that as you lead this team to Africa, Lord, I pray that you would give them safety. Lord, that you would give them perseverance. And Lord, that as they walk into these villages, as they walk into these areas, Lord, that you would guide and direct every step that they have. Lord, every word that they say. Lord, a language barrier that is there, Lord, that you would connect this team and these people, Lord, just through their actions of love and care. Lord, we pray that, Lord, I pray that you would provide what is needed here. This $25,000, Lord, seems like a lot, but when you spread that out over all of our church, Lord, that's nothing. Lord, you own the cattle on 1,000 hills, and I know we're going to take care of this. So that we pray your protection over this team, Lord. We pray that you would prep the hearts and the minds of those kids prep the hearts and the minds of our team, Lord, as they go. Lord, I pray for our team that's going to the Dominican. Lord, that they're going to step into those lives, Lord. They're going to fill those needs, Lord. I pray that you would work in the hearts of our students and our leaders, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray they would melt their hearts, Lord, to become more like you, Lord, to see the people the way you see these people. And Lord, to minister to the hearts and to the needs of the ones who are there. Lord, today our heart breaks as we see pictures online in the news of the devastation of the floods and all the water that is causing so much damage to so many states. And Lord, what we see, Lord, is just is the picture, Lord, but these people are experiencing this loss. They're experiencing their homes being destroyed. They're experiencing their loved ones dying. And Lord, I pray that that if there is a need that we can fill for the lives of these people in Tennessee and Kentucky and Georgia and Florida and all the states that are affected by these storms, Lord, I pray that you would put it in our hearts to do so. Lord, I pray that we as a church, Lord, would never stop wanting to fill needs. That we would be a church that would seek to fill needs. Lord, I'm so grateful that you put us in a place of abundance. And Lord, because you have given us abundance, Lord, that you allow us to share what we have. Lord, I pray that you would help us to never have hands that are so clenched with the things that we have. Lord, that we never get the opportunity to experience what it means to give to those in need. So, Lord, we love you and we thank you. We ask your blessings upon these trips. We ask your blessings upon these teams. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Hey, would you just give not only this team, but give our Father a round of applause for what he's going to do. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me see where we are. As we close down today, you know, when we say that we exist to make Jesus known, this isn't something that we just say, it's something we do. I don't know whether you realize that, but it was the first words of Jesus to his followers, and it was the last words of Jesus to his followers. When he comes along and he sees Peter and Andrew, James and John on the shore, do you remember what he told them first? He said, follow me and I will make you what? Fishers of men. He said, if you follow me long enough, I will put this good news in front of you and you will want to fish, not for fish, but you will want to fish for people. And then the very last words he told them as he left them. In fact, all four Gospels and the book of Acts in some way include his last words to go into all the world, to all the world, and to preach this good news of a king who gave his life for the people. For anyone who would believe in that message, he said, this is what I want you to do. I want you to baptize them. I want you to immerse them into this new kingdom, teaching them, discipling them. And then he made this promise, and I will be with you forever, even to the end of the age. We believe that, and we hold that to be true. If you don't know that Jesus, I pray that you become find one of us, talk to our prayer team in the lot today. In whatever way that you can help on this journey, Lee and Barbara and Joyce, if y'all want to go ahead and make your way out to the I'm In station, Haley, they're going to be out there. If you want to talk about the Dominican trip, the African trip, any of that, we invite you to do that. Let me pray over you and we'll be dismissed. Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for loving us. I thank you for being a good and gracious God to us. Father, I pray your protection over both of these teams, but Father, not just these teams, I pray your protection over people who follow you throughout the world. May we be people, Father, who stand up in spite of oppression. Father, may we be a people who shine the true light. May we be that city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. Father, I thank you that there are people alive today, that people in your kingdom today who are halfway around the world because of what a little place in Gallatin, Tennessee, because we said yes to your calling. Thank you for all the people within the sound of my voice. Father, let us ring true for you. Let us live to love you, to love people, and make the story of your Savior and your Son known in all the earth. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.